A representation at the Hotel de Bourgogne. A hall of the Hotel de Bourgogne in 1640. A sort of tennis court arranged and decorated for a theatrical performance. The hall is oblong and seen obliquely, so that one of its sides forms a back of the right foreground, and meeting the left background makes an angle with the stage, which is partly visible. On both sides of the stage are benches. A curtain is composed of two tapestries which can be drawn aside. Above a harlequin's mantle are the royal arms. There are broad steps from the stage to the hall. On either side of these steps are the places for the violinists' footlights. Two rows, one over the other, of side galleries, the highest divided into boxes. No seats in the pit of the hall, which is the real stage of the theatre. At the back of the pit, i.e., on the right foreground, some benches forming steps, and underneath, a staircase which leads to the upper seats. An improvised buffet ornamented with little lustres, vases, glasses, plates of tarts, cakes, bottles, etc. The entrance to the theatre is in the centre of the background, under the gallery of the boxes. A large door, half open, to let in the spectators. On the panel of this door, in different corners, and over the buffet, red placards bearing the words, La Chloris. At the rising of the curtain, the hall is in semi-darkness and still empty. The lustres are lowered in the middle of the pit, ready to be lighted. Scene 1. The public arriving by degrees. Troopers, burghers, lackeys, pages, a pickpocket, the doorkeeper, etc. Followed by the marquises, cuije, brisaille, the buffet girl, the violinists, etc. A confusion of loud voices is heard outside the door. A trooper enters hastily. The doorkeeper, following him.
Hello, you there, your money.
I enter gratis.
Why?
Why? I am of the king's household cavalry, faith.
To another trooper who enters.
And you?
I pay nothing.
How so?
I am a musketeer.
The play will not begin till 2. The pit is empty. Come, about with the foils to pass the time.
They fence with the foils they have brought. First lackey, entering.
Psst! Flanquin!
Second lackey, already there.
Sabed!
Showing him cards and dice which he takes from his doublet.
See, here be cards and dice.
He seats himself on the floor.
Let's play.
Doing the same.
Good. I am with you, villain.
Taking from his pocket a candle end, which he lights, and sticks on the floor.
I made free to provide myself with light to be master's expense.
A guardsman to a shop girl who advances.
'Twas prettily done to come before the lights were lit.
He takes her round the waist. Second trooper, receiving a thrust.
A hit.
Clubs.
Following the girl.
A kiss.
The shop girl, struggling to free herself.
They are looking.
Drawing her to a dark corner.
No fear, no one can see.
A man, sitting on the ground with others, who have brought their provisions.
By coming early, one can eat in comfort.
The burgher, conducting his son.
Let us sit here, son.
Triple ace.
Taking a bottle from under his cloak, and also seating himself on the floor.
A tippler may well quaff his burgundy.
He drinks.
In the Burgundy Hotel.
To his son.
Faith. A man might think he had fallen in a bad house here.
He points with his cane to the drunkard.
What with topers?
One of the fencers, in breaking off, jostles him.
Brawlers?
He stumbles into the midst of the card players.
Gamblers?
The guardsman, behind him, still teasing the shop girl.
Come, one kiss.
Hurriedly pulling his son away.
By all the holies. And this, my boy, is the theatre where they played Rotrou erewhile.
Aye, and Cornelie?
First page, second page, third page, hand in hand, enter dancing the farandole and singing. The doorkeeper, sternly to the pages.
You pages there, none of your tricks.
Oh, sir, such a suspicion.
Briskly to the second page, the moment the doorkeeper's back is turned.
Have you string?
Ay, and a fishhook with it.
We can angle for wigs, then, up there in the gallery.
The pickpocket, gathering about him some evil-looking youths.
Hark ye, young cutpurses, lend an ear, while I give you your first lesson in thieving.
Second page, calling up to the others in the top galleries.
You there, have you any pea-shooters?
Third page, from above.
Aye, have we, and peas withal.
He blows and peppers them with peas. The young man to his father.
What peace do they give us?
Clarice.
Who may the author be?
Master Balthazar Barrow. It is a play.
He goes arm in arm with his son, the pickpocket, to his pupils.
Have a care, above all, of the lace knee ruffles. Cut them off.
A spectator to another, showing him a corner in the gallery.
I was up there the first night of the Cid.
Making with his fingers the gesture of filching.
Thus were watches.
Coming down again with his son.
Ah, you shall presently see some renowned actors.
Making the gestures of one who pulls something stealthily, with little jerks.
Thus for handkerchiefs.
Montfleury.
Shouting from the upper gallery.
Light up, below there.
Bella Rose, Lepay, Le Beaupré, Jodelet.
Third page, in the pit.
Here comes the buffet girl.
The buffet girl taking her place behind the buffet.
Oranges, milk, raspberry water, cedar bitters.
A hubbub outside the door is heard. First Marquis.
Make place, brutes.
First Lackey, astonished.
The Marquises? In the pit?
Oh, only for a minute or so.
Enter a band of young Marquises. First Marquis, seeing that the hall is half empty.
What now? So we make our entrance like a pack of woolen drapers. Peaceably, without disturbing the folk, or treading on their toes. Oh, fie, fie.
Recognizing some other gentlemen who have entered a little before him.
Quiggy, Brisaille.
Greetings and embraces.
True to our word. Troth, we are here before the candles are lit.
Eh, indeed. Enough. I am of an ill humor.
Nay, nay, Marquise. See, for your consolation, they are coming to light up.
Welcoming the entrance of the lighter.
Ah!
They form in groups round the lustres as they are lit. Some people have taken their seats in the galleries. Linier, a distinguished-looking roue, with disordered shirt front, arm in arm with Christian the Noivellette. Christian, who is dressed elegantly, but rather behind the fashion, seems preoccupied and keeps looking at the boxes. Scene 2. The same. Christian, Linier, then Dragonou and Libre.
Ligier.
Not drunk as yet?
Aside to Christian.
I may introduce you?
Christian nods in assent.
Baron de Neviette.
Bows, applauding as the first luster is lighted and drawn up.
Ah!
Cuiger to Brisaille, looking at Christian.
Tis a pretty fellow.
First Marquis, who has overheard.
Pooh.
Linier introducing them to Christian.
My lords de Quigy, de Brisaille.
Christian, bowing.
Delighted.
First Marquis to second.
He is not ill to look at, but certes, he is not costumed in the latest mode.
Linier to Cuiger.
This gentleman comes from Touraine.
Yes, I have scarce been 20 days in Paris. Tomorrow I join the guards in the cadets.
Watching the people who are coming into the boxes.
There is the wife of the Chief Justice.
Oranges, milk.
First violin, tuning up.
La la.
Cuiger to Christian, pointing to the hall, which is filling fast.
Tis crowded.
Yes, indeed.
All the great world.
They recognize and name the different elegantly dressed ladies who enter the boxes, bowing low to them. The lady sends smiles in answer.
Madame de Guimene.
Madame de Bois Dauphin.
Adored by us all.
Madame de Chavigny.
Who sports with our poor hearts.
Ah, so Monsieur de Corneille has come back from Rouen.
The young man to his father.
Is the academy here?
Oh, aye. I see several of them. There is Baudou, Boissat, and Curot de la Chambre, Pocharet, Colombie, Bourzet, Bourdon, Arbaud. All names that will live. Tis fine.
Attention! Here come our Presuisi, Barthénoid, Eurymedonte, Cassadans, Felixiere.
Ah, how exquisite their fancy names are. Do you know them all, Marquise?
Aye, Marquis, I do. Every one.
drawing Christian aside.
Friend, I but came here to give you pleasure. The lady comes not. I will betake me again to my pet vice.
No, no. You, who are a ballad maker to court and city alike, can tell me better than any who the lady is for whom I die of love. Stay yet a while.
Striking his bow on the desk.
Gentlemen violinists.
He raises his bow.
Macaroons, lemon drink.
The violins begin to play.
Ah, I fear me she is coquettish and over-nice and fastidious. I, who am so poor of wit, how dare I speak to her, how address her? This language they speak today, I and right, confounds me. I am but an honest soldier and timid withal. She has ever her place there on the right. The empty box see you.
Ligny, making as if to go.
I must go.
Detaining him.
Nay, stay.
I cannot. Thus, you see, waits me at the tavern, and here one dies of thirst.
The buffet girl, passing before him with a tray.
Orange drink?
Ugh.
Milk?
Ha.
Reeve salt?
Stay.
To Christian.
I will remain a while. Let me taste this Reeve salt.
He sits by the buffet. The girl pours some out for him. At the entrance of a plump little man, joyously excited.
Ah, Ragueneau!
To Christian.
Tis the famous tavern keeper, Ragueneau.
Ragueneau, dressed in the Sunday clothes of a pastry cook, going up quickly to Ligny.
Sir, have you seen Monsieur de Cyrano?
Introducing him to Christian.
The pastry cook of the actors and the poets.
Overcome.
You do me too great honour.
Nay, hold your peace, Messinas that you are.
True, these gentlemen employ me.
On credit. He is himself a poet of a pretty talent.
So they tell me.
Mad after poetry.
Tis true that, for a little ode.
You give a tart.
Oh, a tartlet.
Brave fellow. He would fain excuse himself. And for a triolet now, did you not give in exchange?
Some little rolls.
Severely.
They were milk rolls. And as for the theatre, which you love?
Oh, to distraction.
How pay you your tickets, huh? With cakes. Your place tonight. Come, tell me in my ear, what did it cost you?
4 custards and 15 cream puffs.
He looks around on all sides.
Monsieur de Cyrano is not here. 'Tis strange.
Why so?
Montfleury plays.
Aye, 'tis true that that old wine barrel is to take Fidon's part tonight. But what matter is that to Cyrano?
How? Know you not? He has got a hot hate for Montfleury, and so has forbid him strictly to show his face on the stage for 1 whole month.
Drinking his 4th glass?
Well?
Montfleury will play.
He cannot hinder that.
Oh, that I have come to see.
Who is this Cyrano?
A fellow well skilled in all tricks of fence.
Is he of noble birth?
Aye, noble enough. He's a cadet in the guards.
Pointing to a gentleman who is going up and down the hall as if searching for someone.
But 'tis his friend Lebret yonder who can best tell you.
He calls him.
Lebret.
Lebret comes towards them.
Seek you for the Bergerac.
Aye, I am uneasy.
Is it not true that he is the strangest of men?
True, that he is the choicest of earthly beings.
Poet.
Soldier.
Philosopher.
Musician.
And of how fantastic a presence.
Marriage would puzzle even our grim painter Philippe de Campagne to portray him. Methinks, whimsical, wild, comical as he is, only Jacques Callot, now dead and gone, had succeeded better, and had made of him the maddest fighter of all his visored crew, with his triple-plumed beaver and 6-pointed doublet, the sword-point sticking up beneath his mantle like an insolent cocktail. He's prouder than all the fierce Artabans of whom Gascony has ever been and will ever be the prolific alma mater. Above his toby ruff he carries a nose. Ah, good my lords, what a nose is his! When one sees it, one is fain to cry aloud, "Nay, 'tis too much, he plays a joke on us." Then one laughs, says, "He will anon take it off." But no, Monsieur de Bergerac always keeps it on.
Throwing back his head,
"He keeps it on, and cleaves in two any man who dares remark on it."
His sword, 'tis one half of the fate shears.
Shrugging his shoulders,
"He will not come."
I say he will, and I wager a fowl, a la Ragueneau.
good.
Murmurs of admiration in hall. Roxane has just appeared in her box. She seats herself in the front, the duenna at the back. Christian, who is paying the buffet girl, does not see her entrance.
Ah, gentlemen, she is fearfully, terribly ravishing.
When one looks at her, one thinks of a peach smiling at a strawberry.
And what freshness! A man approaching her too near might chance to get a bad chill at heart.
Raising his head, sees Roxane and catches Linier by the arm.
Tis she.
Ah, is it she?
Aye. Tell me quick, I am afraid.
Tasting his river salté in sips.
Magdalene Robin. Roxane, so-called. A subtle wit, a précieuse.
Woe is me.
Free? An orphan. The cousin of Cyrano, of whom we were now speaking.
At this moment, an elegant nobleman, with blue ribbon across his breast, enters the box and talks with Roxane, standing.
Who is yonder man?
Who has become tipsy, winking at him.
Aha, Comte de Guiche, enamoured of her, but wedded to the niece of Armand Richelieu, would fain marry Roxane to a certain sorry fellow, one Monsieur de Valvert, a viscount and accommodating. She will none of that bargain, but de Guiche is powerful and can persecute the daughter of a plain, untitled gentleman. More by token, I myself have exposed this cunning plan of his to the world in a song which, oh, he must rage at me. The end hit home. Listen!
He gets up staggering and raises his glass, ready to sing.
No, good night.
Where go you?
To Monsieur de Valvert.
Have a care. It is he who will kill you.
Showing him Roxane by a look.
Stay where you are. She is looking at you.
It is true.
He stands looking at her. The group of pickpockets, seeing him thus, head in air and open-mouthed, draw near to him.
Tis I who am going. I am athirst, and they expect me in the taverns.
He goes out reeling. Lebray, who has been all round the hall, coming back to Ragueneau reassured.
No sign of Cyrano.
All the same.
A hope is left to me that he has not seen the playbill.
Begin! Begin! Begin!
Scene 3. The same. All but Linier, de Guiche, Valver, then Montfleury. First Marquis, watching de Guiche, who comes down from Roxane's box and crosses the pet surrounded by obsequious noblemen, among them the Viscount de Valver.
He pays a fine court, your de Guiche.
Faux, another Gascon.
Aye, but the cold, supple Gascon, that is the stuff success is made of. Believe me, we had best make our bow to him.
They go toward de Guiche.
What fine ribbons! How call you the colour, Count de Guiche? Kiss me, my darling, or timid fawn.
Tis the colour called sick Spaniard.
Faith, the colour speaks truth, for thanks to your valour, things will soon go ill for Spain and Flanders.
I go on the stage. Will you come?
He goes toward the stage, followed by the marquises and gentlemen. Turning, he calls.
Come you, Valvert.
Christian, who is watching and listening, starts on hearing this name.
The Viscount, ah, I will throw full in his face my...
He puts his hand in his pocket and finds there the hand of a pickpocket who is about to rob him. He turns round.
Hey!
Oh!
Holding him tightly.
I was looking for a glove.
Smiling piteously.
And you find a hand.
Changing his tone quickly and in a whisper.
Let me but go, and I will deliver you a secret.
Still holding him.
What is it?
Linier, he who has just left you.
Same play.
Well?
His life is in peril. A song writ by him has given offence in high places, and 100 men, I am of them, are posted tonight.
100 men? By whom posted?
I may not say. A secret.
Shrugging his shoulders.
Oh.
With great dignity.
Of the profession.
Where are they posted?
At the Porte de Nestle, on his way homeward. Warn him.
Letting go of his wrists.
But where can I find him?
Run round to all the taverns. The Golden Wine Press, the Pine Cone, the Belt that Bursts, the 2 Torches, the 3 Funnels, and at each leave a word that shall put him on his guard.
Good. I fly. Ah, the scoundrels. 100 men against 1.
Looking lovingly at Roxane.
Ah, to leave her.
Looking with rage at Valvert.
And him. But save Lanier, I must.
He hurries out. De Guiche, the Viscount, the Marquises have all disappeared behind the curtain to take their places on the benches placed on the stage. The pit is quite full. The galleries and the boxes are also crowded.
Begin!
The burgher, whose wig is drawn up on the end of a string by a page in the upper gallery.
My wig!
He is bald!
Bravo, pages! Ha ha ha!
Furious, shaking his fist.
Young villain!
Total silence.
What means this sudden silence?
A spectator says something to him in a low voice.
Is it true?
I have just heard it on good authority.
Murmurs spreading through the hall.
Hush!
Is it here?
No.
Aye, say.
In the box with the bars in front.
The cardinal.
The cardinal.
The cardinal.
The devil. We shall have to behave ourselves.
A knock is heard upon the stage. Everyone is motionless. A pause. Cuijé, in the silence behind the curtain.
Snuff that candle.
Putting his head through the opening in the curtain.
A chair.
A chair is passed from hand to hand over the heads of the spectators. The Marquis takes it and disappears, after blowing some kisses to the boxes.
Silence!
Three knocks are heard on the stage. The curtain opens in the center tableau. The Marquises, in insolent attitudes, seated on each side of the stage. The scene represents a pastoral landscape. Four little lustres light the stage. The violins play softly, libre, in a low voice to Ragano.
Montfleury comes on the scene.
Aye, 'tis he who begins.
Cyrano is not here.
I have lost my wager.
'Tis all the better.
An air on the drone pipes is heard, and Montfleury enters, enormously stout, in an Arcadian shepherd's dress, a hat wreathed with roses drooping over one ear, blowing into a ribbon drone pipe, applauding.
Bravo, Montfleury! Montfleury!
Montfleury!
Montfleury, after bowing low, begins the part of Phédon.
Heureux qui, loin des cours, dans un lieu solitaire, se prescrit à soi-même un exil volontaire, et qui, lorsque Zéphyr a soufflé sur les bois.
Cyrano, from the middle of the pit.
Villain, did I not forbid you to show your face here for a month?
General stupor. Everyone turns round, murmurs.
Hey! What?
What is it?
The people stand up in the boxes to look.
To see.
Cyrano.
King of clowns, leave the stage this instant.
Oh!
But
do you dare defy me?
Different voices from the pit and the boxes.
Peace.
Enough.
Play on, Montefiore. Fear nothing.
In a trembling voice.
Heureux qui, loin des cours, dans un lieu sol.
More fiercely.
Well, chief of all the blackguards, must I come and give you a taste of my cane?
A hand holding a cane starts up over the heads of the spectators, in a voice that trembles more and more.
Heureux qui.
The cane is shaken.
Off the stage.
Oh!
Choking.
Heureux qui, loin des cours.
Cyrano, appearing suddenly in the pit, standing on a chair, his arms crossed, his beaver cocked fiercely, his moustache bristling, his nose terrible to see.
Ah, I shall be angry in a minute.
Sensation. Scene 4. The same. Cyrano, then Belarus, Jodelet. Montfleury to the Marquises.
Come to my help, my lords.
Carelessly.
Go on, go on.
Fat man, take warning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.